name and your roll number is already visible. So please type your name so that I will take your attendance from that in the chat box. Okay, I have taken your attendance now. Okay, don't send the attendance randomly, because if you join late, then I won't be able to spend much time on the attendance part. Okay. All right. So we start today. Whether my slide is visible to you? Okay. Very good. Very good. So today's first lecture is as per the timetable, it is of Ami madam, but she is on leave, so I am taking her lecture. So in one of my online lectures, she will remain present. So if you miss first 5 minutes, then I won't be able to grant you attendance. Hence, don't type otherwise. Now, nobody should send any attendance, because we can chat on. You can send a questions or any other query you have on that. Okay. All right. So let me start now. So this subject, network and information security, is very important subject from the knowledge point of view. You will be studying computer network in this semester, and in this course, network and information security, the goal is that when the information is transmitted over a network, how that information can be protected so that no other unauthorized person will be able to use it, right? So that is the main focus of this. So there are two aspects. One is network security and second is information security. So I will be talking mainly on the syllabus is mainly on the information security side, and there are also certain aspects which are related to network security. However, any information security discussion which we take, which we carry out, that is directly applicable to network security also, right? Because ultimately the information is going to be transmitted over network. So the two books which are mainly used are Cryptography and Network Security by William Stallings and Cryptography and Network Security by Behrouz Forozan and Devdeep Mukhopadhyay. So this second book is mainly used. However, there are certain aspects which can be taken from this first book. So this is the book of your interest. Cryptography and Network Security, Behrouz Forozan and Devdeep Mukhopadhyay. Let us first understand the introduction part of this course. The first and important part is that the information is an asset that has a value like any other asset. Like you must be seeing that your parents, your father or mother, or both of them are working, and they have created, they have earned the asset, right? So your house is your asset, your bank account is an asset, right? So what do? You try to protect it. If you have a land, you try to protect it. So that is an asset, right? For doing a business, oil is an asset, right? Similarly, information is also an asset, and that has a value like any other asset. You all must be hearing these words, big data, data science, machine learning, all these things, right? So all these things depends upon the basic requirement is data, huge amount of data. So it is an asset. Okay, it is very important. So this asset information needs to be secured from attack. For example, we have our country have land area which has borders with some neighbors. So if they try to capture our territory, we call it as an attack. It is an attack on our asset, right? Similarly, if you have a house and somebody else occupies that, then it is an attack on your house. Similarly, this information is an asset, and there is a possibility that an attack may happen so that the information is stolen. Now, there are different types of information. One information is that is crucial, critical information, or something which should be kept as hidden or secret, like war, during the war, the war plan. Okay, so it is an information, but it needs to be secure. But from the customer point of view, customer's data is a very important information. It should be kept as secret, right? Your bank account number, it should be kept as hidden from unauthorized person, right? So all these things should be secure from the attacks. There are three goals for the security. They can be in confidentiality, integrity, and availability. So let us understand each of these goals one by one. So this is CIA. So you can remember these three goals as CIA. C means confidentiality, I means integrity, and A means availability. So let us discuss first confidentiality. So we need to protect our confidential information. There are different types of information. Some information are confidential information. It should not be given to a public domain. It should not be given in public domain. Or it should not be given to somebody who is threatening you. Right? Military point of view, concealment of sensitive information is a major concern. How many warplanes are there and where are they deployed? Right? How many soldiers are there? How many soldiers are there in a particular area? Right? So this is the very sensitive information, and it should be kept as a secret. In industry, there is a lot of competition is going on. For example, somebody who is investing 500 crore in a business, he has certain important information, which is, if his competitor comes to know about, the competitor may try to enter into the market faster than him, right? So that company has certain information which is very crucial to the operations of the organization. In banking, customer's account needs to be kept secret. If you have an account in a bank, it needs to be kept as secret. When we send a piece of information to be stored in a remote computer, for example, you are sending something to the server, okay, or when you are retrieving some information from a remote computer. So what will happen? The data will be either transferred from your side to server side, or it will come from server side to you, right? And this transmission is taking place over a network. So cryptography can achieve this confidentiality aspect of the security. So while we transmitting this information, we need to conceal it. And how to conceal it during the transmission? To conceal it during the transmission, we need to use techniques such as cryptography. Yes, generally, it is encryption. And that is the main point I will discuss now. So that is the first goal, confidentiality. Second goal is integrity. In integrity, I think this topic is more related with your database system concept. In your database management system, have you studied this integrity aspect? What is the meaning of integrity in database? Can anyone say? Database management system, have you studied that subject? Database management system. Is saying consistency of database. Group data together, reliable, constrained. So many things are there. But I think chance, accuracy of database. Yes, yes. Yes, very good. So this is more closely related with the integrity aspect. Kaushal Chowdhury is saying used to maintain the quality of information. Used to maintain the quality of the information. Not the quality, but the information should be up to date, right? So accuracy or integrity, right? Reliability is generally, yes, but reliability is more about the operation, lossless. Keval, verifying the data is successfully returned to the database. Exactly. So this accuracy aspect or the quality of the information or the data should be successfully returned, these all are actually the operations which takes place when the database operations are carried out. For example, you have bank account and you have 10,000 rupees in your bank account. Now you are withdrawing 5,000 rupees out of it. Then the bank account should update the 5,000 withdrawal immediately when you are withdrawing, and the remaining balance should be shown, right? So it should not happen that you withdraw 5,000 but the bank account is not updating your record. Then what will happen? You may give a check of 10,000 but your bank account has only 5,000 rupees in your account. So this check will not be cleared. Right, so this is the integrity, atomicity. Atomicity shall, yes, when an operation starts, it must be completed and no other operation should take place while one operation is taking place. That is atomicity, yes. And that is the effect of atomicity is the integrity. We can say that, right, shall? So information needs to be changed constantly. So from the information point of view, information point of view, we are talking about integrity aspect in the context of network security. Okay, we are talking about integrity aspect from the network security point of view, and one of the goal is integrity, and this information needs to be changed constantly. As I told you, that bank account needs to be updated. So in a bank, when a customer deposits or withdraws the money, the balance of our account needs to be changed. Okay, and integrity means that the changes needs to be done only by authorized entities and through authorized mechanisms. So here the meaning of integrity is that the information needs to be changed, but it should be done by authorized entities and through authorized mechanism. That means that you are withdrawing the money, and suppose you are going to the bank, and from the cash counter you are withdrawing the money. So only that cash counter accountant, he is authorized to deduct money from your bank account. Suppose if you are performing online transaction and you are transferring your one account to another account, then only authorized person who has login and password, that is you, only you should be able to perform it, or the person who has login ID and password should be able to perform it. Okay, and through the authorized mechanism. So it should not happen that one customer who logs in can perform transfer without getting OTP, and another construction gets transfer the amount with OTP. So the mechanism should be authorized, and it should be in a proper way, right? This is the meaning of integrity in the security goal point of view. So if the authorized person is not performing the transaction, then what will happen? Then your account may be changed by an attacker, which may damage you, harm you, right? So integrity violation is not necessarily always by the attacker. It may also happen because of the interruptions of the system. So many times you must have observed that you have stored some file, but that file gets corrupted, and the reason for that corruption is power supply failure. Any of you have come across that situation till now? Because power supply goes down, it corrupts your file system. Any of you have come across that situation? Right? Very good. So Dhruv, Janil, that is the learning lesson, that it is while booking the train ticket. Yes, Kevar, very good. So it is possible that the integrity violation may take place not necessarily by the attacker, but mainly because of the some other technical issue like power surge. So it will change some information. Suppose your bank account has 1 lakh rupee, and accidentally 10 gets deleted, what will happen? Your account balance suddenly reduced to 10,000. So it should not happen, right? So integrity aspect is taken care by hashing algorithm, and the examples are SHA-256 and MD5 algorithms. Availability is the third security goal. The information created and stored by an organization needs to be available to the authorized entities. For example, customer database is stored in a company. So company's authorized people should be able to access the customer's data so that they can prepare and provide them offers. Okay, bank is having customer data and customer is having bank account. So customer should be able to log in to online banking system so that customer can access his or her own bank account. Right, you have trading account, right? Anybody is aware about stock market? Very good. So there are 6 or 7 or 8 people who are familiar with the stock market, and you must have seen that there are demat account. Yes, Rural. You must have seen that there are terminals and online trading is taking place. That is, you buy the stock and you sell the stock, right? So if you have demat account in which, Dhruval, you have certain stock, for example, Reliance Industry stock, 100 shares of Reliance Industry or 100 shares of TCS and 100 shares of Infosys are there, okay? So TCS 100 shares are there, and the when you bought the share at the cost of let's say 1,000 rupees per share, so 100 such shares are there, Now, today, the share price has increased from 1,000 to 10,000. Okay. And today, you want to sell these 100 shares. So, because you are getting 9,000 rupees of profit per share, so you want to sell it. So, in a particular moment, if you want that information that I want to sell it, I want to first view total number of shares which I am having. And if I don't get that information, then that is the issue of the availability. For example, you are not able to, even if you are authorized user, your password is changed by the system or somebody else, then you will not be allowed to use the system. If you log in, but you will not be able to see how many shares you are having of TCS, then you will not be able to sell those shares, right? Even if the current price has increased significantly. So if you miss that moment, you will have a loss. Now suppose the price has come down to 5,000. So what you could not do at the price of 10,000, even if you do it at 5,000, you are actually losing large amount, right? So that is the main issue, that the information created and stored by an organization needs to be available to authorized entities. And information is useless if it is not available, right? So suppose some company has stored his employees' data type, employee data, and a company wants to know that total number of employees are there and how many total how much amount of money is spent on salaries of all the total employee. If accountant is not available, the authorized person is not available, then that information cannot be accessed, right? Even if you have the information, but you don't have any authorized person to fetch the data, then that is unavailability. Now, some important decision is required to be taken, and that information is not available, then it is useless, right? So, information needs to be constantly changed, and which means it must be accessible to authorized entities. The unavailability of information is harmful. So, what would happen? Just imagine what would happen to a bank if the customer could not access their account for transaction. Many times you are getting emails and SMS messages from the bank companies that from this date, night 11 p.m. to morning 7 a.m., the banking operation will be shut. Have you come across such messages in your mobile phone or email from your bank? So during that time, they are informing you that during that time, the server, some technical issues, maintenance time is there. And that is why they are not able to provide you services. Now, just imagine that during that time, something important comes in your requirement, right? And you are not able to access it. Then what will happen? This is certainly a problem, right? And if the good part is that the companies, bank companies, they are informing us. If they do not inform us, and if we come suddenly such situation, like your mails are coming into your Gmail and Gmail service is suddenly not available, then you will not be able to log in, right? In that case, you will not be able to access the Google Meet, right? So these are some of the important issues. So this it is done by denial of service attack. So it may slow down or totally interrupt the services of the system. It is the this unavailability is called as denial of service. So let us understand this confidential. So these are the three security goals: CIA, confidentiality, integrity, and availability. Now, confidentiality. What is a confidentiality? If a sender sends a text message to the receiver, then the receiver should receive concealed text message. Okay, this concealed, suppose you are posting a letter, right? So if you want to post a letter, what you will do, you will take one envelope and in that you will put a letter and then you will seal the envelope and that envelope you will post to the post office. So when the receiver will receive it, he will open the envelope and the receiver will be able to read the letter. So that concealment, right, should take place with this of this text message, right? Concealment. So when we transmit the data over a network, at that time it should be concealed. It should not be the same message, because otherwise there is a greater chance attack and will steal this important information. So if an unauthorized person receives the message, then the message is hidden. It is kept as hidden because the text message is concealed. Even if some unauthorized person receives it, it will remain hidden. Are you getting this? How the message is hidden? Because it is concealed, right? So encryption is the way to convert this original message to a form which can't be easily decoded by unauthorized person. That means we need to apply some technique. We call this technique as encryption, so that this original message is converted into a form which unauthorized person, even if they receive it, they will not be able to interpret it, right? So you have information, but you are not able to interpret it, then that information is useless. And even if some unauthorized person receives the message, but because it is encrypted, the message will not be able to be useful to that. And it should be made in such a way, the encryption should be done in such a way that it cannot be easily decoded. It cannot be easily decoded. Right? This is a very important aspect. So let us understand some terminology. The original message is called as plain text. Now this terminology will be useful throughout this encryption, this cryptography discussion, right? So original message is known as plain text. Cipher key, okay, CIPHER, cipher key is known as key. So whenever we say key, we actually are referring cipher key, okay? The algorithm through which we convert this original message into a cipher text, that algorithm is encryption algorithm and it is also known as cipher. Okay, and the output of the algorithm is cipher text. So you can see that the sender wants to send some data and that data is plain text. Okay, sender has plain text for transmitting. So sender uses this cipher key over plain text and it produces with this encryption algorithm the output, which is encrypted cipher text. Encrypted text or cipher text. Okay. So this key is usually shared between sender and the receiver. Is this clear to all of you? Any question up to this point? Okay. Right. Okay. Good. Very good. So next is like encryption. Here what happens, encrypted text is transmitted. Okay, encrypted text is transmitted over a network. So on the receiver side, what happens that whatever is received, that is encrypted text. Now receiver will not be able to know what was originally sent by sender. If receiver has to know what is the actual message sent by the sender, then receiver has to perform some operation over this encrypted text. That operation is called as an decryption algorithm. So that is actually the reverse process of encryption. So encryption converts encrypted, decryption makes the reverse of it. So it produces the encrypted text into original or decrypted text, right? With the help of decryption algorithm and with the help of cipher key. And this process is called as decipher, or it is as decipher or decryption algorithm, right? So the decrypted text is same as plain text or must be same as plain text. Why we call it as must be or same as? Because we can make it mandatory that it should be able to produce, decryption algorithm should be able to produce exactly the same message which the original message is sent. However, in some cases, even if 90% or 95% or 98% accuracy is received, that original message is accepted. But most of the time when you are designing encryption algorithm, you are also designing decryption algorithm. Both should take place simultaneously. And in most of the cases, you will find that the decryption must be same as the plain text. Okay, decryption must be same as the plain text. Okay, so if the secret key is guessed, now what happens here, there is a possibility that if what is common here it is cipher key and here also it is cipher key, and these two keys, so sender uses, let's say, cipher key K1, then receiver must use the same cipher key K1, right? Somehow. So receiver and sender both should have first agreed to use key, right? So if this secret key is guessed or discovered by someone, then the cipher text is decrypted and confidentiality is violated. Now see what happens in a network. You have sender and you have receiver. Okay, now suppose you are a sender sitting in Nadiad and receiver is in United States. You are sending email. Now you are not directly connected with United States, so whatever you will transmit, it will actually go through several network elements, right? And the receiver, apart from receiver, there may be some other person who might be receiving those packets. Okay, because the data is usually transmitted in the form of packets. So if some unauthorized person receives the encrypted text and that person knows which encryption algorithm was used and what was the key, then that unauthorized person will be able to get this decrypted text. If that happens, in that case, we can say that the confidentiality is violated. Okay, if that happens, then we say that confidentiality is violated. Is that clear to all of you? Okay, very good. So now let us see different types of cryptographic attacks. Okay, before I discuss this cryptographic attack, let us go to some example. Okay, these attacks, cryptanalytic attacks and non-cryptanalytic attacks, if time remains, I will cover in today's class or maybe in the tomorrow's class. So let me directly move to the example. So the first example is of additive cipher or shift cipher. And this example is also supposed to be implemented in your lab sessions. Those who attended lab, so you are online students, so you have not attended any lab of NIS today. So for all of you, it is for the first time. So additive cipher or shift cipher. So this cipher is simplest mono alphabetic cipher, and it is also known as additive cipher. Okay, the simplest mono alphabetic cipher is the additive cipher, and it is also called as shift cipher or Caesar cipher. Any of you know who was Caesar? Julius Caesar, yes, Harsh. So he was a king. Right. So you must be knowing that when king sends some message to his the general during the war, he doesn't send the message in a plain text. The orders are mostly encrypted, right? So that Caesar used to use this type of cipher, and that is why it is also known as shift cipher or Caesar cipher for shift cipher or additive cipher. It comes, so there are two types of categories. One is symmetric key cryptography and asymmetric key cryptography. This cipher is part of symmetric cipher category. So the algorithm for this additive cipher is C is equals to P plus K mod 26. What is C? C is number corresponding to the cipher text character. Cipher text is what? It is the result of encryption. Okay, it is the result of the encryption. That is the number, and there is a number corresponding to the cipher text character. And what is P? P is total number of P is the number corresponding to the plain text character, right? C is number corresponding to cipher text character, and P is number corresponding to the plain text character. Okay, assume the alphabet set. So in this case, we use alphabet set to be A, B, C, D up to X, Y, and Z. So how many alphabets are there? Right. So that is the total number of element in the set, and they are fixed and unique. Okay, A to Z. So what we do for each of these alphabet, okay, A, B, C, D, E, F, G up to Z, there is a corresponding mapping value. Okay, zero. A means A is mapped to zero. B mapped to one. C mapped to two. D map to 3, okay, like that. Q mapped to 16, L mapped to 11. this was Z mapped to 225. This 25, 24, 23, 22, like that. Suppose our plain text is welcome. Okay. And this is, these all are small letters. And the key which we take, that is 5. So there are 0 to 25. Okay. Out of that, we have selected one key, that is 5. Okay. So this key must be shared between sender and the receiver. So what is, how we perform this additive cipher example, what we have to do is, we have this P information, we have this K information. So what we have to perform is P plus K mod 26. Okay. So first we do that this welcome, this should be in a small letter. Okay. This all characters should be in a small letter. So it's equivalent values we have to take. Now take W, see W equal to 22. So W is 22. E is 4. You can see E is 4. Okay. L is 11. L is 11. Okay. C is 2. So O is 14. You can see that. Okay. Can you see this? M is 12. Can you see this mapping? And E is 4. Are you able to? Is this similar to hashing? This is not exactly hashing. It is mapping. It is only a mapping. Okay, in hashing also you have a hash function, and those hash functions are used to generate key. So the concept have similarity with the hashing, but in hashing you use the, it has a different goal, whereas here the goal is encryption. Okay, Nishit, are you able to understand the difference? In hashing, what happens that there are chances that there will be same key for several data. So you find out solutions, but here it should not happen that characters cannot be uniquely identified, because then it becomes difficult actually to perform the encryption. Because if the same character is having if two different characters have same value, then how will you differentiate? Right? So it should not happen. So it is not considered as good here, and that is why a uniqueness is expected. Nishit, is that clear? Okay. So these values are mapped, and these values are taken now for further. So we apply this function CI equal to PI plus K mod 26. So this is plain text mapping, this is key, and this is plain text plus key. Okay. So suppose plain text is 22. Okay, each character we have to see. W has equivalent value, that is 22, key value 5. So the total value is 27. Okay, 4 plus 5, 9. 11 plus 5, 16. 2 plus 5, 7. 14 plus 5, 19. 12 plus 5, 17. 4 plus 5, 9. Is that clear? Up to this point, plain text plus key is understood. Okay, very good. So now we perform this operation, plain text plus key mod 26. So when we take mod 27 divided 26 27 divided by 26. So what remains is a mod. So 26 multiplied by 1 is 26. So 27 minus 26, that is 1. So the remainder is 1. Okay. 9 mod 26. What is the result of 9 mod 26? 9. Right? Any number which is less than 26 is going to remain as it is. Right? So here what you get is a unique number, a number which is following this function. Okay, it may not be unique now, but for all these characters, but it will be useful to make the text unreadable by the unauthorized access. So these values are then converted into a cipher text. So the text, if you want to send welcome, it's equivalent cipher text by following this function is BJQHTRJ. Is this cipher text understood? Have you understood any question? Okay. Now remember, there is a convention that plain text is in small letters and cipher text is in capital letters. Even if one is mapped to B, right? One is mapped to B. But when you write it as a cipher text, you write capital B. Okay? Right. Now, receiver side, we have to perform reverse operation. So, in additive cipher, the receiver side decryption is PI equal to CI minus K mod 26. Okay, this is the formula. What is the formula for encryption? This. If we want PI, then K should go on this side and mod operation remains as it is. So CI minus K mod 26. Right. So this is, so what is the input to this? We have cipher text at the receiver side and we know the key because key is shared with the receiver. So you have, what you have to do is again the same method BJQHTRJ, its equivalent mapping you have to find out from the same table. Okay, this you use same table. So B is 1, you can see B is 1, J is 9, Q is 16, H is 7, T is 19, R is 17 and J is 9. Is that clear? Sorry, plain. Okay, here. Sorry, we have to see this. 1, 9, 16, 7, 19, 17 and 9. Okay. Now we use key. K equal to 5. It is the same key which is used for encryption. So CI minus K is 1 minus 5, that is minus 4. 9 minus 5, that is 4. 16 minus 5, that is 11. 7 minus 5, that is 2. 19 minus 5, that is 14. 17 minus 5, that is 12. And 9 minus 5, that is 4. Okay. Now what we have to do, we have to get the modulo operation over these values. Now what is the modulo of minus 4, minus 4 mod 26? Can anyone tell me how this value is obtained?
Minus 4 is also n by k mod
Yes, sir, you are right. Minus 4 plus 26. And Janil, you are also right. But after mod 26, add 26. Actually, after mod 26, add 26 is not the right way to say. We should say that to perform mod 26, we have to add 26. Right? If the value is negative. Right? So, how we perform? Minus 4 mod 26. That means minus 4 divided by 26. So what we do, we multiply 26 by minus 1. So we get minus 1 minus 26. I'm talking about mathematical operation, Chanj. You are right for from the point of view of coding. That is point of from coding point of view, it is fine. But this is the way you should understand from basic mathematics point of view. This minus 4 minus minus 26. So it becomes plus 26. And so the result is 22. Is that clear now? Is that clear? See what happens. You have minus 4, right? And you divide it by 26. So what do? You will write 26 multiplied by minus 1. So this will give you minus 26, right? And so minus 4 minus minus 26. So this is minus 4 plus 26, right? So that is 22. Is that clear? Right? So we perform this div operation in order to obtain the mod operation. Okay? Right? So what we get is 22. Is that clear? Right? So the 22, then after we obtain these values, then we have to map it again for these values to the characters. So what we get is the same original text from the Schiffer text. Right? So this Schiffer text is retrieved or decrypted to the original text. Is that understood by all of you? Any question, any doubt? Okay, good charge. Key is randomly generated. Yes, key is randomly generated. How key is taken? Key equal to 5 value is randomly selected from 0 to 25. Why? Because we have 0 to 25, right? So one of the value is taken as key. Yes. Okay. Now use the additive Schiffer with key equal to 15 to encrypt the message hello. Will you be able to do it? Okay, I suggest you that you note down this example. Okay, and solve it when you come next time in online class. Okay, I will show you the solution. Okay, and then you also perform decryption. Okay, you will be able to do that. Okay. Okay, so I will now not discuss those aspects, but there is one more aspect which I will discuss, that is script analysis. So additive cipher are vulnerable to cipher text only. What happens is that because what happened in this particular additive cipher that there are how many keys? 0 to 25, right? Somebody asked that whether keys are generated randomly. So the answer is that yes, it is generated randomly. Why? And from how many possible values? So 0 to 25. Now, if you take k equal to 0, then what happens to the formula? Ci equal to pi plus k mod 26. So if k is 0, what happens? Pi equal to ci? Yes or no? Right? So 0 cannot be taken as a key. Right? So you have how many possible values? 1 to 25. So there are only 25 possible keys. So what happens in a crypt analysis attack is that the attacker, if attacker knows that the cipher text is given, right? If the attacker is able to get the cipher text, and if attacker knows that the additive cipher is used, then for attacker it is very easy because the decryption algorithm is known. Cipher text is known, then all the attacker has to do is to apply this algorithm for 25 different keys. And then what it generates are the possible original messages. And from those possible messages, one of the message is the original message, which he is able to guess easily. Right? So this type of attack is called as crypt analysis attack. Right. So for this example, let us see this example. Suppose that Eve has interpreted the cipher text of this. Okay, this is the cipher text. So how she can use a brute force attack to break the cipher? So Eve has to take key equal to 1, 2, 3 up to 25 and then convert this cipher text to plain text. Right. So what happens that these characters which are cipher text, they are mapped to that numbers as per that table. Okay, then by taking key equal to 1 2 3, when it is producing 7, when it is using k equal to 7, the cipher text minus key values will be like this and the mode value will be like this and its equivalent message will be like this, not very secure. Okay, so this operation, it is supposed to be applied for 25 different keys, and one of the message which will be a meaningful message, original message, can be guessed. Okay, this is called as crypt analysis attack. Is that clear? Right, so in your lab also you will have to perform this 3 tasks, and the rest of the topics which I showed you, those topics I will cover in the next class. Okay, all right, so I stop here for today. I took the attendance in the beginning of the lecture. Okay.